If you're a coffee lover, you are no doubt familiar with the Greenville-based coffee chain known as Liquid Highway. They're the ones that give all their profits to charity and, as they put it, saving lives one cup at a time.
But in recent years, Liquid Highway has not only closed most of its locations, their charity license has been suspended, and the store owes millions of dollars after a string of lawsuits. Tonight News 4's Tim Waller is looking out for you with a story most Liquid Highway customers haven't heard, Tim.
Well, to hear the owners of Liquid Highway tell the story, Nigel and Gabrielle, their troubles have everything to do with the economy, which they say took a big nosedive back in 2008. Yet 4 years later, with millions of dollars owed to banks, vendors, and private individuals, Liquid Highway is still in business, and some of the people who filed legal actions against them are speaking out.
Medium through, we're just cream, right?
It's one of the most recognized coffee names in the upstate, with its familiar mission statement out front.
That's our heartbeat. Our heartbeat is to give and help. That's our heartbeat.
Liquid Highway is known for giving all its profits to charity. And owner Theda Vaughn says they've given a lot.
We're the first people that if somebody wants something free, we're the first people they call.
But in recent years, Liquid Highway, which had grown to 16 locations across the upstate, has dwindled to just three, with the owner blaming the economy for the demise of this once thriving business.
We didn't realize when that happened, I guess, the impact that people would stop buying coffee. They would stop spending $5 on a latte.
And it wasn't just that. Vaughn says what happened in 2008 was the perfect storm. She says banks stopped lending, credit lines were pulled as new stores were being built, and sales decreased by 40%. Liquid Highway owed millions of dollars and had no money to repay it.
I mean, I can't even tell. It's almost comical. It's just so unreal. You know, but it's far from comical because people are impacted in a real way, and not a good way.
People like Tad Mallory, owner of West End Coffee, who lost $18,000 to Liquid Highway after he says they stopped paying for coffee supplies they had purchased.
The first time I think the reason was, we forgot to transfer money.
But Mallory says it's what he learned later that disturbed him even more.
You found out it wasn't just you.
Absolutely. Out of the people that are owed money, I was on the bottom end of the ladder. And I know it goes in excess of hundreds of thousands of dollars.
In fact, when Liquid Highway started buying products from Mallory in December of 2009, another coffee vendor, Cafe Imports of Minneapolis, Minnesota, had just severed ties with Liquid Highway. Why? $43,000 worth of unpaid supplies, more than twice than what Mallory lost.
I feel fortunate, you know, that I wasn't one of those other guys.
And there were others. Delano's Coffee Roasters, based in Sumner, Washington, had filed a lawsuit. Like Cafe Imports, they too were owed $43,000. But Delano's didn't believe Liquid Highway was broke. The lawsuit referenced the owner's apparent access to capital and resources in 2009, at a time other coffee locations were shutting their doors due to economic struggles. New Liquid Highway stores were being opened, they said. Employees were being hired, and free drinks were being served. But perhaps the most damning allegation in the lawsuit had to do with Liquid Highway's owners. 10 years earlier, Theda Vaughn and her husband sold their shredding business for more than $22 million, which, according to the lawsuit, they unjustly refused to apply toward their debt.
It's been by the grace of God. I mean, it's not there. I wish it was there. It's not.
Vaughn says that $22 million from the sale of her business was spent a long time ago, well before they purchased Liquid Highway in 2006, on taxes that were due and debt they still owed, not to mention about $6 million they gave to their church and used to fund their charitable foundation.
They're hurting other people, and I don't know that they see that.
Doctors Matt and Ann Bynum were also left hanging. They sold their chain of Brick House Coffee Stores to Liquid Highway and are still owed $1.2 million.
I would have taken half at this point than have nothing. But we didn't have that opportunity. We had somebody that approached us, they wanted it, they took it, and then they didn't do what they were obligated to do.
We've refinanced our house and our dental office and our lake house and
trying to sell things right and left. It's like a fire sale up at Bynum's.
The Bynum's also sued and won a court judgment, but say so far they haven't received a single penny. That's because the list of judgments against Liquid Highway is long. Banks, vendors, equipment suppliers, office leasing companies, even credit card companies are owed more than $4.7 million.
There's the property when we first bought it with a house on it.
That doesn't include the money still owed to Rod and Donna Williams, who began Liquid Highway in 1998 and sold it to the Vaughns in 2006.
We're not getting a penny. Anytime someone talks to me about Liquid Highway now, the first thing they bring up is, oh yeah, that's the shop that gives all their profits to missions. And that's very noble, but if they're giving it away, that's my money they're giving away.
As far as that goes, Liquid Highway hasn't given any money to charity through their private foundation since 2008. Their Touch the Ground Foundation was suspended by the South Carolina Secretary of State's office in 2009 when it failed to pay a fine for a delinquent financial report. Plus, Vaughn says there's no money to give.
You know, when your kid comes up to you and says, Mom, don't forget, I need a pair of shoes. Don't forget, I want to get this for my birthday. And you can't do it. And you rely on friends and family to help you.
Vaughn insists everyone who is owed money will be paid back eventually when the economy improves and when property they own finally sells. In the meantime, Liquid Highway, with three locations, still advertises they're saving lives. But how?
We are still saving lives with our time and our talent. We don't have money to give away right now, but we will again one day. That's saving lives one cup at a time is every bit as true today, if not more, than it was back then.
It's just tough, to see the banner out there of giving all of our profits away, and yet the trail of carnage is strewn about in their wake, and people need to understand that.
Mallory says he's angered by the fact that Liquid Highway is still open while owing so much money to so many people, and that they're still flying that banner out there that says, saving lives one cup at a time.
Now, since they're no longer a registered charity, are they allowed to say that?
Vaughn says because they're not actively soliciting donations, they're not going out and asking people for it, they're not violating any state laws.
A picture may be worth a thousand words, but some are worth millions of dollars, depending on the picture, of course.
An upstate man believes he is sitting on a gold mine with a rare photo of Billy the Kid, the famous Western outlaw. But proving it's a photo of the real William Bonney hasn't been so easy. So tonight, we will let you decide. News 4's Tim Waller is looking out for you with a Billy the Kid mystery that began on eBay.
He really bought it on eBay?
Yeah, for $9.99. Huh? And I know what you're thinking. How could a picture of somebody bought on eBay for 10 bucks be Billy the Kid, right? Well, Justin Shaw has an eye for this sort of thing, as you're about to see. Plus, he's not the only person who believes this 1800s tintype depicts the real Billy.
Reap the whirlwind, Sheriff Brady. Reap it.
We don't need to explain who Billy the Kid was. Nearly 50 movies have been made about the legendary outlaw.
And I sure would like to touch the gun that's going to kill Billy the Kid.
And we know what the real Billy the Kid looked like, thanks to this tintype from the 1800s. It's the only authenticated photo of William Bonney, and it sold at auction this year for $2.3 million.
He has a very, very distinct face.
But Justin Shaw of Spartanburg believes he owns another Billy the Kid tintype.
Once you find so many similarities, you're past the point of no return. There's no one else that it can possibly be.
Shaw found the photo on eBay. It was an auction for an antique tintype of two young, well-dressed men. Neither man appears to resemble Billy the Kid, at least the rough-cut outlaw of legend. But Shaw couldn't take his eyes off one of them.
If you look at the known image, the authenticated image, having seen that image 1,000 times, I knew, it was just like instantaneous. I said, that has to be Billy the Kid.
He's talking about the man who is seated in this picture, who is far more clean-cut than the man in the authenticated photo. But Shaw says the two men are one and the same, and he bases that on the tiniest of details.
When the eyebrows match up perfectly, when the distance of the eyes match up perfectly, the length of the nose, this nostril is bigger than the other nostril, just like that nostril is bigger than the other nostril. And in addition, he's wearing the hat the exact same way, and he's holding his head the exact same way.
The more similarities Shaw points out, the more you begin to see a resemblance. But if you're still not convinced the man in Shaw's photo is Billy the Kid...
The way we compare images is by normalizing two faces.
Consider this video in which facial recognition expert Robert Schmidt compares the known image of Bonnie to Shaw's image.
In this case, we'll mark the eyes of the old photo of Billy the Kid. Then we'll take the picture from the photograph that you have and we'll mark the eyes. Then we'll do a comparison of the two pictures.
The results are astounding, to say the least.
And you can see how the features line up almost exactly. The mouth, the nose, the ears, and in fact, the nose looks so similar that it's startling.
And watch what happens when he places one photo on top of the other and blends the two images together.
Watch the nose as it goes from one nose into the other. It's almost identical. Watch the mouth. You can see how the mouth moves from one photo to another and becomes almost exactly the same.
Schmidt later told News 4 the men in the photos are the same person, no question about it. But Shaw says no one in the collector's world will take his image seriously because of something he doesn't have.
Provenance. Provenance and a clear line of descent.
Because he bought the tintype on eBay, because the seller doesn't know who owned it originally, it's impossible to establish provenance, the item's history of ownership.
Apparently, to historical Western collectors, you have to have a rock-solid story that goes behind the image in order for the image to be authenticated.
This is a painting that's been quite in demand over the last few years.
But it's not just tintypes from the 1800s that require provenance in order to be authenticated. In the art world, provenance means everything to collectors and curators like John Nolan of the Bob Jones University Museum and Gallery.
Provenance is as important as maybe the value it can add to your piece. Just maybe value historically, value monetarily.
Take, for example, the painting over Nolan's right shoulder. It was valuable to begin with based on age and other factors, but its provenance was circumstantial at best. After months of research, Nolan was able to trace the painting to its original owners, Napoleon and Josephine. And guess what that did to the painting's value?
The value definitely has gone up.
But no amount of detective work can establish the history of ownership for Shaw's tintype.
Does that bug you? Does that bother you?
Oh, it's I have lost sleep at night trying to figure out a way to establish a rock-solid provenance.
And strangely enough, the way that he wears his hat, slightly cocked to one side, is also the same.
Shaw believes his high-tech analysis should be enough to prove this is the real William Bonney.
I'm 125% convinced. There is no one else in this world that it could possibly be.
And that is just one battle Justin Shaw is fighting. He also claims to have an original photo of John Wesley Hardin, another famous Western outlaw. Plus, he has photos of Doc Holliday, Wyatt Earp, Frank and Jesse James, Bat Masterson, and the Clanton brothers from the gunfight at the OK Corral. But these are all photos he bought on eBay, and just like that photo of Billy the Kid, none of them can actually be authenticated.
Quite a collector there, Tim. Okay, so what exactly does Shaw want?
I think he wants a couple of things. First of all, he wants people in the Western memorabilia collector's world to acknowledge that he just might have the real thing. And also, he's kind of looking for that big payday. I mean, the one photo, the authenticated photo, sold for $2.3 million.
I mentioned this during the story. Isn't it possible that this person that he has a picture of could be a relative or someone different?
It is possible, says Robert Schmidt, the facial recognition expert, but he says it's highly unlikely. He says the two photos are a perfect match according to that forensic program you saw there. And unless Billy the Kid had a twin brother, the gene pool, Schmidt says, just isn't that large, particularly all the way back in the 1800s.
Really interesting story. Enjoyed it, Tim. Thank you.
It's a lesson we're taught as children. In fact, I'm trying to teach my children this right now. Look both ways before crossing the street. But people who ride their bicycles on the Swamp Rabbit Trails say looking both ways not enough.
Yeah, you see, the trail, which stretches across Greenville County, crosses over a couple of busy highways, and cyclists say getting from one side to the other can be a challenge, to say the least. Tonight News 4's Tim Waller is looking out for you with what some say is an accident waiting to happen. And Tim, there have already been quite a few accidents.
Yeah, quite a few. Of course, anytime you build a bike trail, what's going to happen? You're going to have people crashing their bikes. You're going to have injuries out there. But what these people are talking about are a couple of very specific areas that pose an extra danger. Trail officials say they're working on a remedy right now to fix it. But for some, that hasn't come soon enough.
When it comes to bike trails, few in the country compare to Greenville's Swamp Rabbit Trail. Just ask anyone from out of town.
Tampa and Orlando, they have a couple of bike trails, but nothing, you know, nothing like this.
The foliage for someone from Florida, it's absolutely breathtaking.
The trail is 13 miles long and paved for the smoothest of rides. The best part is most of the trail is away from car traffic. Most of it.
I think it's a matter of time before someone gets killed.
That's what everyone says about the Swamp Rabbit Trail when they have to cross one of two busy highways. The worst crossing is here at Highway 253, where cyclists literally take their lives into their own hands.
It's healing okay.
Robert Lockaby has the scars to prove it.
Somebody from this direction blew their horn at me and it distracted me and I just dumped it right there, right at the median. So consider myself very fortunate that no one came from that direction and hit me.
And there are plenty of stories just like his, according to PJ Laughlin of the Great Escape Bicycle Shop.
How many stories do you hear about people getting injured on the trail?
On the Swamp Rabbit Trail, we actually hear it on a daily basis.
Because it's not just traffic that makes this crossing dangerous for Swamp Rabbit Trail riders. You must also cross without running your tires into the grooves of these old railroad tracks, which may look easy, but isn't.
Some other people were heading towards me, and I went to turn my wheel so I could make room, so we could pass each other. And my front wheel went in between the metal track, and the rail, and it threw me off my bicycle.
Loretta Lamond spoke to us via Skype from her home in Reno, Nevada. She is the mother-in-law of News 4 executive producer Janice Lamond, and was here in April when she crashed her bicycle while trying to cross Highway 253. Lamond suffered injuries to her head and leg and is still in rehab more than 6 months later.
It's just sad. It's sad that they had have a beautiful trail and they didn't think it through.
It's a challenge. I mean, it's how do we...
But Ty Houck, the trail manager, says there are no easy solutions to these dangers. He says paving over the tracks, as many have suggested, would only make car traffic go faster.
In the situation we're in right now, I mean, you can kind of look at those, the rails themselves, the visual recognition of the muscle memory we have, what rails do when you drive over with a car, they act kind of as speed bumps. No one wants to go flying at a speed bump, for the most part, for 45.
Another option is to install flashing lights to remind drivers to slow down and be on the lookout for pedestrians and cyclists. But Houck says the safest and most permanent solution is a bridge that would route trail riders over traffic. But that, too, has its challenges.
How much is a bridge?
The estimates for the West Blue Ridge Highway Bridge range from $300,000 to $1.7 million.
You don't have that money sitting in a bank account?
I wish.
Houck says the money is attainable through grants, but it could take a while to secure it. In the meantime, cyclists will just have to be careful, along with everyone else trying to get to the other side.
Ty Houck, the trail manager, says the whole thing has been a learning curve. He says we're still rookies when it comes to maintaining a bike trail and, of course, keeping it safe. But Houck hopes that within a year, bridges will be added to those dangerous intersections. And of course, he's also working on getting some yellow flashing lights out there just to remind all those drivers you saw in some of the shots to slow down and be on the lookout.
Wow.
Now, I run on the trail, and I know there are signs on the trail that there's a bad intersection coming. Do the cars have that sign as well?
Cars have it, but you know how traffic goes sometimes. People are doing their own thing. They're out there very often not paying attention. But there are signs reminding bicyclists cyclists out there to first of all, get off their bikes and walk their bikes across the road. The day that we were out there, a lot of people just chose to ride on across. Still very dangerous despite all the signage when you actually cross over those roads.
Late last year, when it was discovered the governor and her staff were deleting emails on state computers, there was a huge uproar. That information is supposed to be saved for future generations.
And while the governor has since promised to work more closely with the Department of Archives and History on developing an email policy, the guardians of our state's historical records have another problem, and it's a big one. Tonight News 4's Tim Waller on why people 100 years from now may have no idea what our leaders today were thinking. Tim.
Which is hard to imagine, Nigel and Gabrielle, since we have so much technology at our disposal. But it's all this technology that's posing the problem for the people whose job it is to keep the records of our elected leaders.
It used to be a routine process, keeping up with the writings of South Carolina's governors.
We're talking tens of thousands of square feet of this.
At the Department of Archives and History in Columbia, there are 35,000 cubic feet of documents dating back to the 1600s.
Legalization of tattooing, video poker.
Any kind of government document from ever produced from the state of South Carolina, produced from any municipality, any form of government within the state of South Carolina, that's what you can find here, with the earliest document being from 1671 into last year.
Every governor in the history of South Carolina has some type of document on file here, like the letters to Governor David Beasley when the Confederate battle flag flew atop the State House. One citizen wrote, "I am ashamed of that action," while another said the flag should remain exactly where it is.
Congratulations, you're a winner.
And here's a letter to Governor Jim Hodges about the lottery from someone who was against it. "Dear Mr. Hodges, I plan to vote no. I believe you'll be looking for another job in 2 years.
Teaching teachers has to be the mission of the entire university."
We also found Governor Dick Riley's handwritten notes on how to improve education in the state. And we stumbled across rare photos of Governor Carol Campbell closing the deal on BMW. But ever since governors started using email, there isn't much paper to speak of.
A lot less paper. I mean, so the only paper that you see now, or the majority of the paper you see now, is in a very formal kind of response to something.
The problem with email is the Department of Archives and History doesn't have a good way to save them. Yes, they can transfer emails to a hard drive, but that's like tossing a needle into a haystack.
I mean, it's one thing to capture an email message and then put it on a hard drive. It's another thing to make it easy for researchers to find that message amongst any number of messages that might be on that hard drive.
Today, we have launched a strike on the financial foundation of the Global Terra Network.
When President George W. Bush left office 4 years ago, there were 200 million emails to be archived, 20 times more than what was left by the Clinton administration, since email had become more widely used. One difficulty for archivists is that email messages tend to be short and require other emails in the thread to be understood.
We will have more and more messages with less and less content in the future.
Emerson's agency has small amounts of electronic data from Governors Campbell, Beasley, and Hodges. But those records exist only in paper form because they were printed out and filed like regular documents.
So I want to thank each one of you.
Governor Sanford left behind 20 gigabytes of data, which archivists are still going through now.
We've had a lot of people come into my office to talk to me.
And there are no records yet from Governor Nikki Haley. But that's expected, since archiving takes place at the end of an administration. Governor Haley caught flack for deleting certain emails, which she said were of no historical value. And that's another thing archivists must deal with.
I somehow think there's an association in people's minds that it's not substantial. It's not worth keeping. It's not, it won't be enlightening in the future because I just fired this off. But it's hard for people to make that assessment unless they're an archivist, unless they're a historian, unless they have an idea of what researchers are going to be looking for in the future.
The governor's office has promised not only to retain all emails, but help create a policy that's in line with the 21st century. But that raises another question.
If a public official uses Facebook, is that a public record? How do you document that?
Brian Collars is a digital archivist whose job is to figure out exactly what to save. He says Facebook, Twitter, the governor's official website, even a personal site may contain items of historical value. But right now, he says, there is no way to capture it.
It's like trying to put fingers in the dike. It's awful sometimes, you know, you plug something over here and another one leaks over here.
Eventually, the Department of Archives believes someone somewhere will find a solution.
There will be the kind of imagination and ingenuity to do it, but it won't come cheap.
Until then, the only sure record of history is what's already stored in boxes from our past.
When it comes to archiving social media, there has been one promising advance. Twitter has donated its entire digital archive to the Library of Congress in Washington. That means we have a permanent record of famous tweets, like when President Barack Obama, you can see it right here, said, "We just made history." This was right after winning the 2008 election. And it goes back even further. Here's the co-founder of Twitter, he's not a politician, Jack Dorsey, announcing in 2006 that he was setting up his Twitter account. Nigel Gabriel, you can see why archivists are interested in these type of things, but, you know, capturing and then storing them in some way that'll make sense to researchers in the future, we're just not there yet.
Ever wonder why so many people get taken by scams, especially the elderly? Well, an upstate woman says the answer to that question is not as simple as you might think. New at 6 tonight, News 4's Tim Waller is looking out for you with a scam victim story that she says could happen to anyone.
$4,700. $9,997. It's garbage. That's all it is garbage.
We can't show you the woman's face.
There's no check with that.
The 78-year-old asked that we don't.
If I could kick myself so hard, I thought, how stupid. I was stupid.
What we can show you is the mail she's received from scam artists all over the world. Several giant bags worth that cost her dearly.
How much are you out?
I am out $17,000.
$17,000 over 3 years. It started with a word game she entered and was told she won.
Here's my car. How do you like it? Doesn't have no wheels on it, no keyhole in it, nothing on it, not even a fender, but it's got a key. And I don't have the car and I don't have the money.
She says that scam led to another and another, and now she's inundated with scam letters.
Send half to them and keep half for you. Put it on your half under the pillow, under your pillow that you sleep on, and in the morning, you will have great success.
All this, and not a word to her family.
Did you tell your daughter?
No.
Why?
Because I was guilty. I thought they're going to think how stupid Mom was. Why did she do that? Why didn't she use that money on herself to get things that she didn't have when she was younger?
I told Victoria, the name we're using, she doesn't seem like a person who would fall for these scams. She is well-spoken, her mind is sharp.
How many other people do you suppose they've done this to?
Hundreds, thousands.
Why then did she send the scammers money? Her answer? To help her grandchildren.
I was doing it for them, trying to do it for them, put them in a better house, maybe a better house, give my grandsons cars, they're old enough to drive. And their parents won't buy them a car. They have to earn their car. But I thought, well, maybe I could earn it this way.
Now she hopes to earn the trust of others her age with this word of advice.
Don't do it. If you see it, tear it up before you even open the envelope. Because the eager people, they stole from me because they needed money, my money.
Tim Waller, WYFF News 4, Greenville County.
The woman's family is now aware of what happened, and all payments to overseas scammers have stopped.